Well, welcome to Family of Christ, everyone, where we exist always for three purposes: to meet Jesus, to make friends, and to make a difference. Couple things to highlight. Remember that if your kids are in the 6th, 7th, or 8th grade coming up now with school starting, be sure to get a hold of Mr. Hiller. Pete would love to get your kids registered for confirmation. Along with that, on Sunday, September 12th, we're going to be having a back-to-school event for all the kids in our church, so look for details about that online in the next couple of weeks. Finally, Sunday school for all ages. So for adults, for our youth, and our children, that will all start at 9 o'clock on Sunday, September 19th. And then during the late service at 10:15, while there's a worship service, there'll also be an intergenerational study. So we hope that everyone jumps into at least that two-hour commitment on Sunday mornings. Let's make our beginning today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's sing together our opening song. Well, for our confession today, let's look at this Bible verse from Romans chapter 8, verse 7. It says, "The sinful mind is hostile to God. It doesn't submit to God's law, nor can it do so. So our minds, apart from God's grace, are depraved and filled with wicked thoughts. That's why we can easily be distracted from the things of God. And we can find ourselves instead adopting and conforming to the sinful attitudes and patterns of the world around us. So let's silently confess whenever we trust in our own abilities more than to submitting to God's will and His commands. And let's silently confess whenever we're more concerned about our own interests rather than the well-being of others. Let's do that together silently. Well, I have great news to share with you. Jesus, because He became one of us, because He lived our life, because He paid for all of our sins on Calvary's cross with His blood, and because He rose triumphantly from the grave, thereby proving that His payment was sufficient for the sins of the world, as you and I trust in Christ, not only are we fully forgiven in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, but when we were baptized, we're given the minds of Christ. And throughout the rest of our lives, the Holy Spirit continually tries to renew and make our minds and our thoughts more and more Christ-like through the power of the gospel. Let's take a look at two sections of God's word today. First of all, from Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, and this will be the text for today's message. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. Our gospel reading for today is from Luke chapter 6, verses 46 through 49, which emphasizes not just knowing God's will and word, but putting it into practice. Jesus asks, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I say? As for everyone who comes to me and hears my words and puts them into practice, I will show you what they are like. They are like a man building a house who dug down deep and laid the foundation on a rock. When the flood came, the torrent struck that house, but could not shake it because it was well built. But the one who hears my words and does not put them into practice is like a man who built a house on the ground without a foundation. The moment the torrent struck that house, it collapsed and its destruction was complete." Here ends the gospel of our Lord. Well, at this time, let's profess together our faith on these foundational truths found in God's word as they're all put together for us in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's sing together now our sermon song.
Be Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me save that Thou art. Thou my best thought by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, Thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Open my eyes to see what your eyes see. Open my heart to follow where you lead. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart, High King of Heaven, my treasure thou art. Open my eyes to see what your eyes see. Open my heart to follow where you lead. Open my eyes to see what your eyes see. Open my heart to follow where you lead. High King of Heaven, my victory won, may I reach heaven joyous, O bright heaven's sun. Heart of my heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all. Open my eyes to see what your eyes see. Open my heart to follow where you lead. Open my eyes to see what your eyes see. Open my heart to follow where you lead. Where you
I woke up this morning with a normal feeling for me. It felt like sadness, but more like hunger than anything else. The closest word for it is empty. Whatever the feeling was, I wanted it to go away. Within an hour of waking up, this feeling's usually gone. Coffee can do it, catching up on sports, and by the time I check my email, I'm good. At least I'm full for the present. The feeling, whatever it was, is gone. But quite easily, I slip back into the emptiness. If not the next hour, the next day. Technology gives me the quickest, most instantly gratifying fill. That's why I like social media. All I really need is one like on Instagram, and I'm golden. Facebook can do it too, as long as it's about me. And I look on Twitter to get my sarcasm fill for the day. It doesn't really take much, but it doesn't really last long either. If social media doesn't do it, music always fills me up, especially when I'm driving. I got my tunes, the open road, and I can listen to whatever I want. I rock the same songs over and over again. I was empty. Now I'm filled. I have millions of ways to fill up. I didn't even mention TV, movies, or beach vacations, alcohol, cars, home improvements, accolades at work. Whatever I want, I can have it. With the touch of a button, or the drop of a hat, The world is at my fingertips. I can fill myself with whatever I want, cash pending. All I have to do is convince myself that it's good to eat and desirable for food. Then it's just a matter of plucking my choice fruit from the tree. No wonder I don't need God to be filled. I'm already full.
Well, out of that powerful video, let's pray together. Lord, it's so easy to fill ourselves up with hollow and meaningless substitutes. So fill us with your Spirit and Word so that our minds are renewed and our lives are transformed for Christ's purposes. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Well, today we come to this huge hinge point in our study of the book of Romans. In Romans chapters 1 through 11, the Apostle Paul clearly explains the gospel, how we are justified, forgiven, made righteous, and saved by trusting in what Jesus has already done for us. Well, now, in the rest of the book of Romans, chapters 12 through 16, Paul emphasizes that knowing God's word should lead to doing God's word, that embracing godly beliefs should generate godly behavior. In other words, it's never enough to simply know God's truth. At some point, you and I must put it into practice. And in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, the Apostle Paul boils down that in two statements what it means to live the Christian life. Look at that, what he first of all writes in at the beginning of this verse. Offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. And then secondly, he writes, and do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by, here's the phrase, the renewing of your mind. So Paul begins by calling all Christians to a higher level of commitment by urging us to be living sacrifices. Now, that's a strange and contradictory statement, isn't it? For the last time I checked, sacrifices are typically dead. Still more, that statement, living sacrifices, it's an oxymoron, similar to word combinations like bittersweet, icy hot, and deafening silence. Nevertheless, I didn't see any of you bringing bulls, lambs, or doves to church this morning because there's no need for these sacrifices anymore. Since Jesus, the Lamb of God, has already willingly offered himself as the once-for-all sacrifice on Calvary's cross to fully pay for the sins of the world, including yours and mine, no animal sacrifices will ever be necessary again. Instead, we respond to Christ's limitless and matchless love by re-offering our living lives to him every day. We joyfully re-up as his devoted disciples every single day because we can't imagine what our lives would be like without Jesus. And that's what's so great about the gospel. Not only does it have the power to save us, but in the next few weeks, we're also going to see that it also empowers us to live the Christian life, even when we're swimming upstream against the world's currents. So let the Holy Spirit speak to you again today through Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Don't conform any longer to the pattern of this world. In other words, don't copy the broken world's corrupt behaviors, values, and customs, or get squeezed into its mold. Instead, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Now, earlier, all of us owned up to, in our confession of sins, that we're born with sinful and selfish, defiled and depraved minds. Consequently, it's impossible for us to renew and reorient our minds spiritually. We can't somehow fix ourselves by working harder or looking deeper within ourselves. Only the Holy Spirit can bring about this inner transformation, step by step, little by little, over our entire lifetime. Now, let's look at a couple of Bible passages that highlight this truth. First of all, the Apostle Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5, though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons that we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to do what? Demolish strongholds. So we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. So what's a stronghold? Well, it's a fortified prison that our spiritual enemy, the devil, is constantly trying to lock us into mentally. And he does this through lies and deception. Now, what are some of these lies that Satan regularly whispers to you and me? You can't trust anyone. You can't let anyone know the real you. Do you think God could really love and care about you? Do you think God will ever forgive that sin? You'll never be good enough or amount to anything. You'll never get over your past. Your life is always going to be a mess. Lie after lie after lie. No wonder the Apostle Paul tells us to do two things. First of all, he directs us to demolish, to crush these strongholds. And secondly, he tells us to take captive every single thought, especially those that aren't from God, and make them obedient to Christ. Why does this matter? Because our lives always move in the direction of our strongest thoughts. So if God can change our thinking, he can change our life. But unfortunately, the devil also knows this truth. That's why our minds are constantly a battlefield, where Satan attacks God's truth and promises with his lies and deception. So let's take a moment to do a thought audit. Have your thoughts most recently been more positive or negative? Has your mind been preoccupied lately with more peaceful thoughts or anxious thoughts? Have you recently been reflecting and contemplating more on earthly matters like what's in it for me and how are my needs being met? Or are they on eternal matters like how can my life bring more glory to God and be a blessing to others? Well, far too often, my mind is racing out of control, leaving me in a stronghold of deception, far from where God intends me to be. And I'm sure the same is true of you. So how does the Holy Spirit empower us to take these negative thoughts captive and make them obedient to Christ? Now, keep in mind what I mentioned earlier. We can't transform or renew ourselves. Only the Holy Spirit can do this. So what role do we play in this process as believers? Well, look at this verse from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 25. Everyone who competes in the games goes into strict training. They do it to get a crown that will not last, but we do it to get a crown that will last forever. So although we can't renew ourselves, we can strictly train, arrange, and discipline our lives, thereby increasing the likelihood of our transformation by the Holy Spirit. Take, for example, running a marathon. How many of us, honestly, right now could run a marathon? I mean, if we tried really, really hard. Well, only a few of us could do that. But if we diligently trained over the next 6 months, many of us could eventually do this. Well, the same thing is true of learning to speak a foreign language. Unless we intentionally are pouring into it with vast discipline, it's going to be impossible to learn. But nevertheless, here's the point. Our training and discipline greatly increase the likelihood of our transformation. Well, the same thing is true spiritually. Here's a little equation that I want you to remember. T plus HH plus GE equals SG. In other words, time plus holy habits plus godly encouragement will equal spiritual growth. In other words, when you and I intentionally set aside time each day for holy habits, like reading and studying God's word, praying, listening to Christian music, and when we worship and receive the Lord's Supper regularly, and then on top of this, surround ourselves with Christians for encouragement, accountability, and fellowship, like being involved in life groups and Bible classes, well, we're going to grow and mature spiritually. But this won't happen randomly or accidentally. It takes discipline and intentionality. But by doing this, we greatly increase the likelihood of the Holy Spirit changing our thinking, renewing our minds, and empowering us to walk more deeply in faith. This eventually will then become our default mode. Now let's make this practical. How does the Holy Spirit rescue us from our strongholds of deception? Well, first of all, the Holy Spirit helps us to identify what's holding us back. And He does this as we pray and seek His wisdom and discernment. So what lie is imprisoning you at this time? What deception is confining and restraining you mentally? Do you ever think, I'm not lovable? I'll never be good enough. I don't deserve this kindness. I'll always be broke. I'll never have a deep, meaningful relationship, and on and on. Whatever that stronghold is, name the enemy's lie. You can't defeat what you can't define. Then, after the Holy Spirit has helped us to identify the deceiving stronghold, it's time to demolish it. And how does the Holy Spirit do this? Well, look again at 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 and 4. It says there, though we, Christians, live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons that we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have the divine power, right? The heavenly power, God's miraculous power to demolish strongholds. So the powerful offensive weapon that we all possess for smashing and crushing strongholds is God's Word. And look at how God's Word, the Holy Scriptures, are described in these two verses. First of all, chapter 23 of Jeremiah. Is not my word like fire and like a hammer, like a sledgehammer that breaks rocks in pieces? Or how about Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12? You know this famous verse. For the word of God is living and active. It's sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates. It cuts through everything, even to the dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. So when Satan whispers to you and me, you don't have what it takes, we demolish that stronghold with God's sledgehammer, right? His truth. From 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. We tell Satan, hey, the one who is in us is greater than anything that we encounter in the world. Or how about when Satan whispers to us, you can't, you'll never succeed. Once again, no. We smash that stronghold with the Word of God. We can say something like Philippians 4, verse 13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Or when Satan spreads his lie, you'll always be miserable and hurting. We once again demolish that stronghold by saying the Word of God. How about Nehemiah 8, verse 10? In those circumstances, we say, get lost. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Or when the evil one declares, you'll always be lonely and alone. Once again, we crush that stronghold by proclaiming God's promise in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5. God says there, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. When the accuser whispers to us, you will never be able to overcome your problem or addiction. Once again, we smash that stronghold by declaring Romans chapter 8, verse 37. We are more than conquerors through Him, through Christ, who loves us. You see, the sooner you and I recognize that we aren't who that evil one says we are, and we replace his lies with God's truth, well, what does that truth do? It sets us free. We're no longer locked in these self-imposed prisons of deception because Jesus always opens the door. As the Holy Spirit keeps renewing our minds and making our thoughts more and more Christ-like through the power of the gospel, this changes everything. Suddenly, we have time to do what God wants us to do, and we're equipped to carry out everything that the Lord wants us to do. And then this awesome scripture passage describes you and me in Christ. From 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, God's divine power has given us everything we need to live a godly life. So let's close with this verse from Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. The Spirit has already given us the mind of Christ. And remember, this didn't happen accidentally. It was God's gift to you and me through the waters of holy baptism. And though Satan will continually attempt to deceive and imprison us with his lies, we can train and discipline ourselves through the equation T plus HH plus GE equals SG. Time plus holy habits from godly plus godly encouragement will always equal spiritual growth. Then, armed with God's living, active, and powerful word, we're going to keep demolishing these strongholds by the Holy Spirit's power as he works daily through the gospel. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father, how can we thank you enough for setting us free with your truth? When our thoughts are racing and we're overwhelmed with fear, anxiety, worry, and negative thinking, Lord, help us. Empower us to take our thoughts captive to the truth of your word. Whatever is holding us back and imprisoning us, help us recognize that this isn't from God. Instead, by your Holy Spirit's power, we're going to choose a different road. We're going to walk in your truth and promises. Then, empowered and set free by your gospel, our minds will be renewed. Our thoughts will become more and more Christ-like, and our lives will be transformed for your purposes and glory. Jesus, sometimes we get weary swimming against the tide. Sometimes we feel overwhelmed by the power of the world around us. We're seduced, we're squeezed, and sometimes we give in. Thank you for the power of your forgiveness daily flowing from Calvary's cross. And now open our eyes and renew our minds. Lord, do whatever it takes to break our attraction and addiction to this dying world and replace it with fervent love for you. Lord, continue to pour out your physical healing, strength, and compassion on these people who need your mercy. Audrey Benny, Ann Drexel, Ron and Julie Evenson, Lauren Ingalls, Glenn Jakes, Karen Larson, Scott Melby, Linda and Bill Steinke, and these people whom we silently name in our hearts. Into your hands, Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord, who has taught all of us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We sing together now our closing song.
Jesus, all our
our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Everybody has trials and temptations. Heartbreak, isolation. But we can lay our burdens down. Lay our burdens down. What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon. His heart is my home. Everybody has fears. Everybody's got worries. Everybody knows sorrow, devastation. But we can lay our burdens down. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon, and forever and ever his heart is my home. No more betrayal, for he is faithful. He fills me up and my cup runneth over. No more betrayal, for he is faithful. How he has proven it over and over. No more betrayal, for he is faithful. He fills me up and my cup runneth over. No more betrayal, for he is faithful. Sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon, and forever and ever his heart is my home. What a friend we have in Jesus. East to west, my sins are gone. I see grace on every horizon, and forever and ever his heart is my home. Forever and ever, his heart is my home.
Well, receive the great benediction from our Lord right from the end of Numbers chapter 6. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Let's head out today with these sending words right from God's word. Who has known the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. We take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Don't conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. With our minds renewed and reoriented by the power of the gospel, let's go in peace and serve the Lord. God's richest blessings on your week.